Good afternoon, everybody. It is time for your weekly Mavs episode of Take That With You. Mark Folliwell, Brian Damaris will join me shortly. It is time to talk all things Mavs. And ever since our podcast has moved into the friendly confines of Mavs Studio 41, we've enjoyed the faithful support and partnership of NTTA as the title sponsor of Take That With You. Calling all Mavs fans, you can score now with an official Mavs toll tag. Not only does it keep the Mavs front and center on your windshield, but it cuts your toll bill in half, and the colors are too sweet. Get yours for just $19.99 at getmytolltag.com, small sticker, big savings. Obviously, I'm in Studio 41 today after the Mavericks won in Houston last night and play a TNT national exclusive broadcast game on Tuesday night in San Francisco. That game can be heard on 97.1 The Freak, the flagship station for Dallas Mavericks radio broadcast, with Chuck Cooperstein on play-by-play and my podcast partner, Brian Damaris, who joins us now from one of my favorite hotels, the Team Hotel, in San Francisco. His bed is not visible today, so we won't know whether or not that he made his bed, which he didn't do last week. But that's okay, because I don't do that.
I got feedback on that.
Yeah,
I got several people that said, "Hey, Betty." Now the question I have is, do you make your bed in hotels?
Very rarely. No, I don't do that very often. So,
but when you have a live podcast going to upwards of 5,000 people, you make it. I got you.
I either make it or make sure it's not in the background, one or the other.
It's right there, but the windows are here, and I wanted the natural light, so this is a better angle. But we got in at, I entered my room with my bag, because, you know, sometimes the bags take a little bit of extra time to get to the hotel, at 1:30 Pacific time, which is 3:30 on our body clocks. It was a 3-hour and 45-minute flight to San Francisco, where we were just the morning before 90 minutes away in Sacramento.
Well, it's been a crazy road trip for the Mavs, but a successful one now at 4-0 after their win over the Houston Rockets last night. Real quick, before we delve into all things Mavs over the course of the last week, and there is a lot to talk about. Perhaps you noticed the hat. Congratulations to the Alabama Crimson Tide, my grad school, who did move on to the Final Four this weekend. We actually watched together some of the North Carolina game on Thursday, Brian. Thrilling, exciting win in which Grant Nelson played outstanding basketball. And then they had a comeback win against the Clemson Tigers in the regional final on Saturday night. And Mark Sears, who gives me some Jalen Brunson vibes a little bit, left-handed and kind of looks like him. Sears, the leading scorer in the Southeastern Conference, came to life. And once he did, it was church for the Clemson Tigers. But that was a great game and the first ever Final Four for Alabama. You know, they're the closest team, to be honest with you, in college basketball to an NBA team. They play at a high tempo. They take shots early in the shot clock. They lead the nation in scoring. And Nate Oates, their head coach, is very, very committed to either threes or shots in the paint. So that's how
they
play.
You went to a game. You went to a game last year, didn't you?
I did. Yes, I went to Coleman Coliseum in Tuscaloosa to see Alabama and Auburn play an unbelievable game. Their final regular season game of the 2022-23 season. So,
and our good friend Kevin Sullivan is a nervous wreck about Purdue, but they they made it through.
Yes, they did.
And his angst will continue. So, yes, looking forward to that. My bracket is absolutely horrendous, but I don't watch a lot of college basketball.
That's okay. You know, that's why it's so liberating, Brian, not to do brackets anymore and just watch the game for the sake of watching the games. All right, speaking of watching the games, we did a whole lot of game watching, of course, Brian, over the course of the last week, as you and I were there for the two games in Sacramento, or at least I was there for one of the two, you were there for both, and the game in Houston. So let's get started with what happened over the course of the last week with the Mavericks going 3-0 on the segment of the road trip since the last time that you and I did a podcast. Of course, they beat Utah to start the trip. So they're 4-0 now on this five-game trip. But it's very important to discuss the ramifications of going 3-0 over the course of the past week. Normally, we save standings for the end of the podcast, but it's the time of the year, and given what happened last week, Brian, to get into exactly the ramifications of the standings as it relates to what happened with them going 2-0 in Sacramento and then beating Houston, because, Brian, the Mavs have now moved up into a tie with the Pelicans for fifth place in the Western Conference. We see it right now, and there are those Mavs at 45-29. Brian, they've opened up a two-game lead over the Kings. They're two better in the loss column now than the Phoenix Suns. And, I mean, last week was just ultra, ultra big and important for this team.
Okay, so give me we're looking at division record now with the Pelicans. Give me the update on the division records and what the teams have in division going forward.
So I'm sure most people remember that the Mavs and Pelicans split their four games. So head-to-head is 2-2. That's the first tiebreaker, of course. And that, since that's tied, then because the Mavs and Pelicans are both in the Southwest Division, then we go to division record. Dallas is 10-5. New Orleans is 9-6 remaining. The Mavs play Houston here at American Airlines Center in a few days, Sunday afternoon. And the Pelicans still have a game to play against San Antonio. And by the way, San Antonio has been a thorn in the side of some good teams lately, including the Knicks, spoiling the Jalen Brunson 61-point game, and the Phoenix Suns, which was a nice win from the Mavs' perspective as well.
Okay, so if we take care of the business against Houston, we win the division and then win that tiebreaker. Is that correct?
Well, they'd have the better division record. Yes, correct. Correct. They would have if they beat the Rockets, if the Mavs beat the Rockets on Sunday afternoon, they would be 11-5 in the division. Obviously, with the Pelicans having already lost six games, they can't catch them. So then that would just solidify that if there's a Mavs-Pels tie in the standings, then Dallas would win the division.
Okay, that's what I was getting at. There are some three-way implications. We can get into that next week, seeing if those play out, but division record comes into play there and head-to-head. And then, of course, the Clippers, we do not own that tiebreaker. If we're trying to get to fourth and we're two games behind that, so we basically need to get three games. We need to improve three games worth where we stand if we want home court in a potential 4-5. So, yes, you knew going in that these two Sacramento games were for sixth place, or at least playoff versus play-in, and you have, well, not locked that in. You've made it that two-game bridge is huge this time of year. And, that is also tied. And then conference record would be the tiebreaker between Sacramento and Dallas. Is that correct?
That is correct, Brian. Yes. And right now,
do you know where that stands?
I'd have to look that up, but I believe that at this point, the Mavs are one half game better. I think that's okay. Where that stands. So it's too close to call, and the Kings still have some Eastern Conference games to play. They're about to go on an East road trip, as a matter of fact. And the Mavs, of course, still have some Eastern Conference games to play. And I just bring that up because you can't, it's not all West games remaining. So there's just a lot of fluidity in forecasting what the conference records are going to be, let alone the overall records, of course. But both
and
teams
you
still have
something,
several conference games.
You mentioned something, and Chuck mentioned this on the radio broadcast. A year ago this time, Sacramento was about where our record was, and they were, what, third in the West?
Yes, that's correct. As a matter of fact, I think we had this on tap to talk about in the broadcast on Friday, but the flow, ebb and flow of the game didn't permit us to do that. But through 72 games on Friday, the Kings were 42-30, and last year they were 43-29 through 72 games, and that had them third in the West last year. And they're only one game off their pace from last year, but they were eighth in the West going into the action on Friday night. And obviously the Mavs, opened up a two-game gap on them in the standings. So it's a different Western Conference this year. I mean, the Mavs are on pace now to win perhaps 50 games. And 50 games, last year would have had
you. They just have to go, 5-3 down the stretch to get 50?
Yeah, 5-3 to get to 50. That would have
been. With games against Charlotte.
Detroit.
Atlanta.
Yeah. Teams like that. Yeah, 5-3 would get you 50. 50 wins last year because, by the way, Sacramento was third, and they didn't even win 50 games last year. They won 48 or 49 games last year. So 50 last year would have got you third, and 50 this year is probably going to be around 6, maybe 5. We'll see, what happens with New Orleans and such. But it's a different Western Conference this year, but it's a Western Conference now, Brian, where the Mavs are a factor based on what they've done, and they a bigger factor in terms of moving up in the standings based on what's happened in the last week.
Well, let's talk about the big picture of what happened over the last week before we delve into the games themselves.
Yeah, because what's happened over the last week, Brian, is that now Dallas is sitting here with a 7-game winning streak, which ties a winning streak link that they had earlier this year and one that they had last year, the longest winning streaks post-2011 championship. And they've also won 11 out of 12 games, and that is a distinction of the best 12-game stretch for the Mavs post-title. They have not had a stretch where they've won 11 out of 12 games in the aftermath of winning the championship. So we are seeing some very, very good Mavs basketball right now. It's moved them up in the standings, but it's interesting because the genesis for this point and the genesis for this big picture discussion, Brian, is a question you heard me ask to Jason before Friday night's game in Sacramento, and that is that at that point in time, they were 20 games post-trade. You know, I always go back to what Avery said many, many years ago. I like to look at things in 20-game segments. I think that's a large enough sample size to at least begin to draw some conclusions. And I think Rick Carlisle, of course, you know, echoed similar sentiments in his time here. That represents a quarter of your season. And I think, you know, it's a large enough sample size to say some things. And at that point in time, the Mavs were 14-6 in the 20 games post-trade and have since won two more games. And I brought that up to Kid, and his answer to my question about his big picture analysis was, forget the numbers. Right now, the energy and the trust and the chemistry with our guys right now is as high as it's been all season. And I thought that really is kind of the talking point of this stretch of time for the Mavs of winning 11 of 12. And by the way, those were two words that the Mavs have been gravitating to ever since Jason Kidd arrived here, chemistry and trust.
Well, you go back to the very first article I ever wrote for D Magazine 3 years ago. It was right after Luka's press conference in Ljubljana when he signed his extension. And he said, what's important to you for winning? And he said, chemistry and trust. And that's what Nico Harrison and Jason Kidd have tried to build around. And so when you're looking at, and I talked to several players over the last week, when you have 2 days off in a city like we did in Sacramento, there's a lot of downtime and hanging out, and it was a playoff-like atmosphere, really, and it was a good test for this team. Jason Kidd used it as a, listen, this is what the playoffs are going to be like. You sit in cities and play the same team over and over again, and, you know, this team was loose throughout the whole time, and Kidd made a point of telling me he likes to keep it that way. He wasn't on this team like, hey, these are huge games. Oh my gosh, he's the most important game of the year. We've got to bear down and you know, get intense and have anxiety. It was, we know what we can do when we play our game offensively and do what we're supposed to do defensively. We're tough to beat. And so this team is loose. I had a player tell me it's the loosest team he's ever been on, whether it's in practice or in pregame warmups. You know, Luka's shooting balls off the scoreboard in Houston while the other team is doing these intense layup drills. That's not to say they're taking things lightly. They just know that they have the confidence that if they execute their game plan, then, you know, they're going to be tough to beat. And that's what we've seen. And they have the trust to know defensively, I've got your back on the help. I know what I'm supposed to do. I know what rotation I'm supposed to hit. They have the chemistry that, again, all this started after that meeting, after the Indiana game. Yeah. But they had the trust with each other to respond to that meeting in a positive way. And so all of that, when you talk about the culture that Nico set up, and then the vibe that Kidd has set up, because we know that the coach kind of sets the tone for the gym.
Yes, we've discussed that.
And then your leaders, Luka and Kyrie, setting the tone, whether it's Luka on the court, diving for loose balls, being, you know, top 10 in steals, playing intense, putting teams on his back. And Kyrie, who we had on radio in postgame last night, talking about how his leadership on the court and off the court, you know, I mentioned that to him as one of the things that we've had other people say. Tim Hardaway, after the game, was on our radio interview after the first Sacramento game. And he had had that great game in Utah and then struggled a little bit late in that game and then had a great game, rather, in Utah in the first Sacramento game. And it's like, okay, how did you stay positive during that? And he goes, Kyrie patted me on the back while I was hitting a free throw late in the game when my shot wasn't falling in the second half and said, keep shooting. I believe in you. Mm-hmm. And he said, I listened to that and it meant a lot to me.
Yeah.
And that really spurred me on to play well. And those are the kind of little things that make a difference.
Yeah, and you said something I thought that was really interesting a little bit ago, and that is that, you know, they're loose, but that doesn't mean you aren't taking things seriously. And trust me, you know, we've been around this, and you can take things seriously. But seriously doesn't manifest itself in not having fun and not having high energy and things like that. You know, and I'm the first to say, by the way, that what you see in a shoot-around in terms of approach is not a predictor of how things are going to go that night. I've seen lethargic shoot-arounds turn into great games. I've seen focused shoot-arounds turn into lousy games over the years. But man, Friday, you and I were there in Sacramento at Golden One Center watching shoot-around, and it was really, really interesting to observe the demeanor of the team. Because not only was it loose, but it was also loud and energetic as well, and high energy. I mean, it was a really, really positive vibe. And I think everybody took it, was taking things seriously. But again, seriously doesn't mean that it results in we're like, you know, we have this like blinders on and, you know, everybody's so focused that they can't crack a smile or have fun with each other or laugh. And we're just seeing, you know, from our experience around it, on the periphery of it, we're seeing some really, really good signs right now, Brian.
Yes.
Yep.
And when you look at, again, the overall week, we all, you know, you and I in the media world and the fans were looking ahead to these two Sacramento games. The team had to take care of their business night in, night out before they got there. And then they were able to really hit a playoff type atmosphere like that. And listen, these were, we're going to get into specific games, but these are the biggest games of PJ Washington's career, Daniel Gafford's career, Derek Lively's career, giving them a taste of what it's going to be like in April, May, June. And they all stepped up to that challenge.
Yeah, so let's.
And that was really impressive to me.
Yeah, that's a great segue because that's our entry point for discussing Tuesday night Sacramento game. The Mavs win by 36 points. They win 132-96 in that game on Tuesday night. And to Brian's point, PJ Washington, who has not been in the playoffs, Gafford's been in the playoffs one time with Washington, but you know, it was almost over with before it really got started. And obviously, Derek Lively is the rookie. You know, those guys play in some of the biggest games of their career that night, and the biggest in the case, I would say, of PJ and Lively for sure. And also, Tim Hardaway had a resurgence that night as well. You know, he had 22 points, which is his most points in a game since January 29th. You're seeing right now, if you're watching on YouTube, thanks to Mav Studio 41, thanks to Chopper and DeCat, you're seeing great video right now of Hardaway knocking down threes. You've seen video of PJ Washington knocking down threes. And you'll also see some video here of Derek Lively blocking shots, of Gafford making defensive plays, and also some shot blocks from the next game, because both of those games were big for those guys. And both of them had a real component of contribution based on the interior defense that they played. There was a drive by Monk and a great contest by Derek Lively blocking him. As you watch this video package right now, Lively blocking Chris Duarte on that particular play. Brian, I think the takeaway in terms of that game is not just that the Mavericks dismantled Sacramento, but to your point, and the front end of that two-game series, with obviously a lot of focus and attention on that, PJ, Gafford, Lively, and to some degree, Tim, he's played in big games, but again, he's been in a real slump. All four of those guys under that pressure situation were really instrumental in how they responded and carried the performance for the Mavs that night.
I thought one of the unsung heroes was Derek Lively. His third quarter defense was absolutely phenomenal, whether it was blocking shots,
locking them down,
or disrupting shots. And it's really key that it's not just block shots, but it's making shots harder by being that rim presence. The defense is funneling things into those bigs. That's the system they want to play. And they're just making shots just a little bit harder so that they're off. And then you're getting the rebound. You're able to go the other direction. Remember the first couple of games that Sacramento played. Sabonis had his way.
Yeah, he shot 80%. Remember, we brought that up last week. He shot 80% against Dallas in the first two games.
Right. And so what did the Mavericks do? They packed that paint. They're going to force those shooters from the outside to beat them or move them to the mid-range. And it was a lot harder for Sacramento to get in their offense. And so then you were able to get things going on the other end. If you're clicking on your end offensively, then the Sacramento's a team that's slumping their shoulders and they're feeling that pressure. I thought it was the most complete win of the season to that date because they were able to finally marry the old style with the new style. What do I mean by that? The new style, we talked about it last week, being aggressive, points in the paint, getting your twos. This team hadn't been shooting the ball well. Remember what I said last week on this very podcast, the shooting is going to come around. Well, it came around that night.
Yeah, 22 made
shot.
Threes. Yeah, 22 made
and
threes.
And I had a media member come up to me and go, you know, hey, I don't know if they can, they're not always going to be able to shoot like that. It's going to go back to me. And I just said, but they did shoot like that because that's what they're capable of. And so they're not a victim of make or miss. They have the way they played the 10 games previous to that, by playing the two game, playing defense, attacking the paint. And when you add the 3-point game onto that, you're borderline unstoppable when you add in the improved defense. Itzhak Franco had a really interesting graph last week. He said, if this team plays league average defensive rating, league average, okay, around 114, whatever that number is, this team has lost twice when they play league average defense. The Cleveland miracle shot and the Houston game when Luka didn't play in December.
Wow.
At Houston. Yeah. That's it.
That's it.
That's the bar. And since the trade, here are the ratings. Since the trade, this team has the second best offense, the 10th best defense, and the 4th best net rating. Now, what's your mantra? You like to be top 10 in both, right?
I do,
That's the Falwell paradigm, right?
Yeah, let's call it that. Kind of like Lawler's Law when Ralph Lawler used to do Clippers games. I would say
let's
the first team.
Let's not bring wrestling into this.
No. Ralph, not Jerry Lawler, not Jerry the King Lawler.
Oh, okay.
Ralph Lawler, the Basketball Hall of Fame announcer. Said,
sorry, my bad.
Yes,
my bad.
With the Clippers, Lawler's Law was the first team to 100 wins the game. And so, yeah, the Falwell paradigm is be top 10 in offense and defensive rating, and that gives you a position or puts you in position to compete for a championship.
Yeah,
that is wrestling. By the way, that is wrestling, you know, because that's John Moxley's finishing move, the paradigm shift. So,
all right,
there you go. Yeah,
had to squeeze some wrestling in here, but you're seeing what the model is that this team now wants to play in, and they're starting to get their shot back. We've seen it in the last couple games. Now it's not a fluke. You know, we'll get into what happened last night, but this was the most complete game they played. You had PJ Washington with a Mavs high for himself, 13 rebounds. I thought he had a tremendous game, 14 points, 13 boards. You know, you're seeing what that vertical game can be offensively. You're seeing what that rim protection and that defense brings. PJ Washington's one of our, Luka called him last night, one of our two best defenders on this team.
Yeah.
That is high praise for what he's able to do playing 1 through 5. He was on Sabonis a lot. You know, their motto was, we're going to switch. We'll put somebody else on him like PJ Washington there in the middle and make it harder for him to go left. Guard him on the left side, make him go right. It was just harder for him to do what he wanted to do.
It is really fun to watch PJ play defense because he's long, he's mobile, he has strength. And so when he was acquired in trade, we pointed to versatility with PJ, but we talked about it, Brian, within the framework of offense because he's not just limited to shooting standstill jumpers out of the corner. He can put the ball down. He can handle it. He can drive to the basket because he can handle it. He can create for other people a little bit. And by the way, he had the key assist on the Exum made three at the end of the game on Friday night. You know, he can catch lobs. And so we thought about PJ's versatility and the fact that he was just a more fluid athlete than Grant Williams. We position all of that as impacting his offense. But his defense is really, I mean, as much as anything, is where I'm so impressed by his versatility because he's multi-positional in terms of who he can guard. And you see, again, strength, length, mobility, all of these things that PJ brings to the table on defense. And going into last night's game against Houston, individual opponents, when guarded by PJ as a primary or help defender, are shooting 42.4% going into the game against Houston last night. And that is an outstanding number. He's defended 271 shots with the Mavs going into last night. If you looked at players who've defended at least 250 shots in the NBA this year and looked at 42.4%, PJ's flirting with the top 10 in the NBA in terms of defensive field goal percentage. So he was great. You know, you brought up the rebounding, Gafford, Lively, Tim. I mean, they all check boxes for Dallas on Tuesday night. And that was, and by the way, you know, those guys were so good.
And oh, by the way, Gafford hit, starting with the end of the Utah game and going into that game, was starting to hit those corner threes. And that's going to be huge for
him. Yeah, Washington, yeah.
PJ, yeah. Starting to hit those corner threes. And so we know he can get inside and get that little dotted line game going, that little floater game. But when he's hitting those corner threes effectively, that's just another level this team can get to.
And they were so good. And Luka, of course, had 26 in the first half, but then it was just such a collective beatdown in the second half that Luka didn't even have to play the final 12 minutes and 56 seconds of Tuesday's game, which leads us then to Friday. Now, after the Mavs kicked their butts up and down the Golden 1 center court on Tuesday night, anybody who's been around the league knew that the Friday game was going to feature Sacramento coming out and hitting them in the mouth at the beginning of the game, which they did, and you start seeing the highlights here. And as I put it, as I told Kat to put on the lower third, it was a win that was down and dirty in a street and a down and dirty street fight. And that's really, I mean, it was a very, very physical game. I mean, you just saw the play where Malik Monk, you know, unfortunately got hurt when Luka fell on him. Luka hit the floor hard. He was one of his knees were bleeding, and they had to stop play because of that at some point in time. I mean, it was a knockdown, drag out, brass knuckle street fight that these two teams had on Friday night. And Brian, the game I felt like unfolded in the way that I expected it to, from the standpoint of Kings are going to come out and try to land a haymaker. They were great early in the game. The key for the Mavs would be hang tight, stay connected, show your resolve, and then be in position for your stars to win the game in the fourth quarter. That's what happened. And by the way, what's really, really important is, in talking to some folks after the game, the coaching staff prepared the team for the game to follow that kind of pattern. Be ready. These guys are going to jump on you at the beginning of the game, survive it, stay in the game, realize that you're not going to lose the game. As Hart brought this up on the broadcast, you're not going to lose the game in the first 5 minutes. Stay with it and be prepared to get back into the game. And it's a long game with a lot of possessions, and put yourself in a position to win. And that's exactly what happened in the game with Kyrie. You're seeing some of the highlights of what he did with his 14-point fourth quarter and route to a 30-point game. And then obviously, the Dante Exum performance in the fourth quarter is noteworthy, because on the defensive end of the floor, he forced Fox into three misses late in the game, Brian. And then he was missing some shots himself, but Exum came through with the clutch three with 27 seconds to go. And by the way, the Mavs only led for 2 minutes and 11 seconds in that game. But it was 2 minutes and 11 seconds in the back half of the fourth quarter that proved the difference.
Yeah, Jason Kidd said pregame, he said they're going to come out more physical. They're going to try to run at some pace. The game plan obviously was to take away what Fox and Sabonis were able to do. And so Harrison Barnes and Ellis came out early, really strong offensively for them.
Yeah, really strong.
The Mavs took their punch, but had the resiliency defensively to again pack that paint, make key stops that they needed to make. And then your superstars took over like superstars do. And then you needed somebody else to be able to hit a shot. And you mentioned Dante Exum, who is shooting 50% from three, who has the green light to shoot threes. Jason Kidd said, if you're shooting 50%, I want you shooting those threes. And he missed two big threes. He missed a runner with a minute to go in the game. But the team had the confidence in him. As you mentioned, PJ Washington made that swing pass over to him in the corner for the dagger. You're seeing it right here. You're seeing the miss right there.
Yeah.
That's the confidence that he has. He really likes playing here. He likes that connector role that he has as that third playmaker.
Here you go, Brian.
Closing.
There it is, yeah, right there. It is. Yep. I wanted us to see. We put the misses in the highlight package because I think that tells a really good story. Look at how emotional Dante is. You know, I mean, he was as frustrated as anyone that he missed those shots that he had the opportunity to make earlier in the fourth quarter. And bear in mind, going into Friday's game, Brian, Dante was 6-for-7 on clutch three-point shots this year in the NBA-designated clutch time. He missed two, but there's a trust in everybody on this team, and I think it's really exemplified in the way they kept going back to Dante. And then I thought you just saw a little bit of the highlight there at the end, and you noticed this, I'm sure, Friday. The celebration and the energy from the bench when Dante hit that shot with 27.5 to go. That was really something. And it speaks to our bigger picture point earlier about how tied together the group is and where they stand from a chemistry and trust and energy and togetherness standpoint.
Right. And a lot of people can say, well, when you're winning, everybody's having a good time. And of course they are.
Yeah, of course.
But have that undergirding of the chemistry and trust to kind of take that to another level. These guys like each other, and that goes a long way. And Dante, is playing back at the level that he was playing at before the injury. He's so important for what he does as that third guy that can ball handle, play make, run downhill, as you mentioned, make key defensive stops, hit those key shots. This is the guy who was playing in Serbia last year and was able, kudos to finding him by Nico and his team and giving him a shot. And I was joking with him earlier in the week. I'm like, hey, we haven't had you on the radio interview very often lately. And he's like, I'm gonna get back on there. And he was our radio interview that Friday night. And he said, hey, I told you I'd be on here, meaning you're having a good game. And we want to talk to those guys that have good games. And, you know, that's that kind of, you know, belief that he has. And so, you know, your superstars do that heavy lifting. You mentioned what Kyrie was able to do in the third quarter when they finally broke away. We'll talk about what he was able to do in the fourth quarter last night. Luka, obviously, we know what he brings in the energy, but then you have the defense of the Gaffords and Livelys, the PJ Washingtons, what Exum brings, Tim in his minutes, Jones Jr. in terms of his defense and attacking the basket. You know, it's really, again, it was like the playoffs. You're playing the same team. You're kind of sitting in a city for a little while. You know they're going to make adjustments. This was really a good test for this team to find out who they are, and they're starting to build that identity at the right time.
You know, you said that the Tuesday game was their most complete win, and I don't have any dispute of that. I would say Friday was debatably as gutsy of a win as they've had this year, because it did take going into the game with the understanding of what a war it's going to be, and we're going to have rough patches. That's part of it, because the other guys are professionals getting paid and out there trying to, and you know, it's really, really hard to beat a team twice in a row under any circumstance, but especially when you're the visiting team. And to be prepared for that, and then to have the mental fortitude to be able to hang tight through the tough times, and then, you know, turn to Kyrie. Obviously, we're seeing again the highlights of 14 points for him in the fourth quarter, that driving layup that he just had there where he's switching hands. We know with Kyrie, if the right one don't get you, then the left one will, but that was the case of he had it in the left and switched back to the right. And it's, you know, he's so good in fourth quarters, we almost sometimes take it for granted, or, you know, the way he can, as we'll get into last night. You know, Luka obviously was cooking in the first three quarters, and then, you know, Kyrie only had 9 points in the first three, but then erupted for 15 in the fourth quarter of the game to make sure that that Rockets game didn't get any closer than it did in the fourth quarter. And maybe it's the time to transition right on into that, as a matter of fact, Brian, as the Mavs win last night and they go streak busting in Houston. Brian, for the seventh time in franchise history, the Mavericks stop a winning streak of more than 11 games. The Rockets went in having won 11 straight. And right now you're seeing highlights of the MVP-esque performance by Luka Doncic, which included 47 points, 12 rebounds, and 7 assists in last night's game. He tied his career high with 9 threes. And so there's a lot of good stuff to watch here from Luka Doncic as it relates to the tone that he set in this game, Brian. What did you think about how Luka, who, by the way, was not for sure going to play until 45 minutes or so, maybe even less than that, before game time last night. Yeah, he was questionable with right knee soreness. Kid told us in the 5:30 presser before, or the 4:30 presser before a 6 o'clock game, that he'll be a game time decision, and we didn't find out until 5:30. You know what?
That wasn't gamesmanship. That was a true game time decision.
Yeah,
you have to understand, this team flew into Houston Saturday, two time zones to the east. That's always hard.
Yep.
You just got off two emotional wins that you put so much pressure on. You're playing a team that won 11 in a row, that during their win streak was the second best defense in the NBA. All eyes were on this game because it was the team that had won 10 of 11 versus the team that had won 11 straight. Luka re-aggravated some of that knee soreness in that very, very physical game against Sacramento. Went to the gym early Sunday, did his pregame routine a little earlier than normal to see how he would feel, and 30 minutes before was cleared to play because, frankly, his competitiveness and wanting to play. He could have easily said, you know what, this is a tough stretch. Let's give this a rest, and I'll go Tuesday, as we had to fly back to California last night and play this game Tuesday. But he played, and then he came out and had a stat line that has not occurred in the play-by-play era in the first quarter.
And that was what, 22 points, 8 rebounds, 4 assists, right?
Yeah, that line has never happened in the history of the play-by-play era since 1997. Brad Townsend said, send this to all the MVP voters. Yeah. And then he basically went and had the most points after halftime in three quarters that he's had in his career. You know, he had 47 after three. He ended up there. He just put on an absolute clinic, put the team on his back. you know, he saw Dylan Brooks on the other side and said, I remember you, and I'm going to use that as motivation to play even harder. And, you know, that was a game where a superstar said, follow me, I got this. And then your other superstar, Kyrie Irving, said, oh, by the way, I'm just going to go out and do 15 points in the fourth quarter so that, you know, we'll just close this out. And he said in our radio interview post game, I know when it's my time. I know when I need to give Luka a rest, and I need to take over and be that guy. And for Kyrie just to be able to turn that on and be aggressive and have that steady hand as that second superstar, where it's just thunder and lightning, and you just literally are demoralizing your opponent and making it so difficult for them, is really an amazing thing to see.
Yeah, yeah. We're seeing some Kyrie highlights right now of his 15 points in the fourth quarter. Luka, the 32 that he had at halftime last night is the third highest half of his career. He's had 33 points and a half before. And, of course, he had 41 points in the first half of his 73-point eruption down in
third
Atlanta.
Highest, sorry. Thank you for the correction.
Yeah, he's had 33 before and a half and a half and then 41.
I know the
yeah.
third quarter was definitely a second highest after three.
Yes, yes, with the 50, wherever he was. Where was he on the 73 night? Yeah, the 73-point night. He was in some other stratosphere through three quarters, obviously, that night en route to scoring 73 in the game against Atlanta. But, well, yeah, last night's performance by Luka was just absolutely magnificent. Before we get to something else about Luka, you know, I did like how, again, Mavs defense last night limited Houston to 42 overall percent shooting, held them to exactly 50% in the paint. League average is 57. The Mavs are holding opponents post-trade to a little bit less than 54% shooting in the paint. So that's really important to note as well. And that defense was on display last night. I thought they took Jalen Green out of the game early. Yes. They were able to force guys like, you know, Amen Thompson to have to take threes and Brooks to have to take threes. Brooks went 0 for 8 last night. He was 0 for 7 on threes. Thompson only took one three in the game, but, of course, he doesn't want to take those, going 8 for 56 on three-pointers as a rookie. And by the way, he's having a really nice rookie season and has been quite good, young Amen Thompson has, during their 11-game winning yes. streak. But he's not a three-point shooter. And so the Mavs wanted to either bait him into taking threes or long twos, and he did take some of those and miss those. So, you know, Jabari Smith Jr. always seems to play well against Dallas, and he did do that again last night. But the Mavs contained Jalen Green by and large part. You know, he had got loose for one dunk, but only 12 points in all, 0 for 5 from 3. Brooks was bad last night, didn't make a shot in the whole game, didn't score in 28 minutes, as a matter of fact. And Van Vliet didn't do a whole lot as well last night. You know, the Mavs were very locked in, if you recall Jay Kidd's pregame presser, on getting back off misses and being prepared to play good transition defense against the Rockets, who were playing at a higher pace over the course of their winning streak. So the defensive game plan was very well designed and then implemented in the strategy session. You know, they didn't shoot around yesterday. They had just a pregame meeting and morning breakfast meeting to talk about the opponent-specific tendencies and, you know, design, discussion, implementation, execution of the defensive game plan was great last night. But, Brian, let's move into a little bit more about Luka here.
Before you do that.
Yeah, okay.
Jalen Green hadn't scored under 26 points in his previous eight games. He scored 12 points last night.
Wow.
He'd have been averaging 30 points during their win streak.
Yeah, that's a good note.
But defensively, they had their game plan. They wanted to pack that paint, make him shoot more difficult shots. The rim protection that Gafford and Lively are providing just made those shots a little bit more difficult so that they either got the block shot or they adjusted the shot enough. So they're able to make it harder. Oh, by the way, the three-point shot was again there, just like it was two nights earlier in Sacramento. They had the most three-pointers they've shot, they've made all season, the second most in the franchise history, I believe.
Yeah, 24. Yep.
So again, when you're able to talk about the way they attack the paint aggressively and get their two-point shots, the way they play with this new added pace this season, the way they're playing better defensively, and we've talked about what those numbers are, and I think believe during this streak, they're fourth in defensive efficiency during these last 12 games. By the way, the only loss was when Luka didn't play in Oklahoma City, and that was a tough-fought game. When you add all that together, and you're adding these three-point shots at such a value, and oh, by the way, they're open because of how Luka and Kyrie are shrinking the defenders there. That's the blueprint. That's the way they want to play going forward, and they're doing that, and they're peaking at the right time. So all that together was really on display in this game.
Well, it's wild, though, that on a night when Luka tied his career high with 9 threes, that an outrageous two-pointer is going to be the memorable signature moment of the night, if you will, Brian. Here it is, third quarter. When Jock Landale got switched onto Luka last night, it was curtains. Jabari Smith is more mobile and longer, and this is a well-defended play, and Luka at the end of the shot clock steps under him and hits a scoop to the hoop from just barely inside the three-point line, which resulted in our broadcast saying, "What?" Kind of like Little John. The Rockets broadcast said, no. What did you guys say on the radio last night, Brian?
Coop went ballistic, and I just started laughing.
What else can you do?
I really did.
Yeah.
Because it was, he actually called it a floater, and I said, no, it was underhand. That was a scoop shot from just inside the three-point line. Because remember the Memphis floater that he did to win that game a couple of years ago in the bubble, or in the, when fans weren't there, right?
Yeah.
They were limited fans.
Yep. Yep.
But this was the underhand play that just, there's no way to define it. Did you hear what Luka said after the game about that shot?
Yes, that he had, he related it to his bartending earlier
right.
in life.
He's used to carrying a tray and his drinks like that, and he just threw it up like that. He was laughing.
I would go anywhere. I would go to any bar, by the way, if Luka was behind the bar making drinks. I would be a faithful customer of that bar. So
kind of like Tom Cruise in Cocktail. He's kind of just throwing everything around.
This really is amazing. It broke Twitter last night. Everybody, or X, everybody was talking about it nonstop last night, having a laugh at how our broadcast, how the Rockets broadcast were so amazed by it. The grin on Luka's face is amazing. Just an unbelievable shot. You know, if you ever want to know what Luka magic is, that's Luka magic. That's another example of it right there.
That is it.
That he's able to do that. And
it's a state of being, from what I understand.
It is a state of being. You know, by the way, funny little story about last night. He's out there doing all of the crazy stuff that he does in the layup line. And at some point, he kind of lost his bearings last night of where he was. And right before, we're in an upstairs broadcast location in Houston. So when we're in an upstairs location, we tape our open to the telecast so we don't have to, like, go up there, walk up the stairs during the national anthem. So we're getting ready to tape, and I'm standing there, and we're, like, just a few seconds from starting, and all of a sudden, Luka came crashing into me. I mean, like, and I always joke over the years that sometimes Dirk would, like, be walking in the layup line, and he would stop, and he would, like, slap me like this, you know, to, like, get my attention to high-five me. And I would always say, it's like, you know, Dirk is, like, a gentle giant. He's an amazing guy, but
he has no idea the power of that.
He does not know his own strength. And he would hit me like that in the chest. And, like, this is a 7 foot, 245, 250 pound guy hitting me. And in all seriousness, you know, I think that people don't appreciate what a tank Luka really is, and how physical the game. I mean, he takes a lot of punishment, and he doles out a lot of punishment when he's playing. And just hitting little 6 foot, 165-pound me at half speed before the game last night, you know, almost like knocked me, almost splatted me to the floor.
I'm very disappointed. I didn't see that.
I knew you would have laughed. Yeah, I knew you would have enjoyed that and laughed. But
well, you know, listen, he's the MVP buzz is starting to percolate. Sam Amick wrote an interesting column about it. Bob Sturm, our friend from The Ticket, wrote a column about it. I, of course, wrote about one a few weeks ago, teeing this idea up. And the whole idea was that the team record had to get better. Well, the team record's getting better. We went over that earlier in the pod. And one thing, and he talked about this postgame, you know, he said, I really worked on my conditioning this summer, and his legs are fresher for this time of the year. And, you know, he's still has the size and the bulk to defend the bigs inside when he has to switch onto them, or to back down somebody in the post like a Dylan Brooks or a De'Aaron Fox or somebody like that when he needs to. But he's in better condition. He has his personal team with him. He's, you know, he's really so because of what we saw him buy into that over the summer, those dividends are paying off.
And here's how it's showing up. It's showing up with him winning Player of the Month in February and poised to win Player of the Month in March. He's going to win Player of the Month in the second half of the season twice, Brian. And
so if we look at that, he will be only the second player to win Player, if that happens, and we'll find out
tomorrow.
Today. Is that correct?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow
on Player of the Month,
He will only be, he and Jason Tatum will only be the two only players, depending on who wins in the East.
Which I think is going to be Jalen Brunson. We'll see.
Okay. Yeah. So he will be only, Jokic won kind of that month and a half. So I'll give him credit for that, October, November. And then February and March will be Luka. Mm-hmm. Shea won December. I can't remember who won January. But it wasn't Shea again. So, or Jokic. So multiple, just Luka and Tatum. Players of the Week, which will come out today. You would think he's up there on that list as well. Mm-hmm. He will go ahead by himself with four Player of the Week wins.
If in fact he wins today, yeah.
If in fact he wins. Joel Embiid has three. He's not eligible. Those are the only people that have more than two. So you have to start thinking in terms of, well, what does that mean if he's winning these awards during the season? You know, we have to start giving him that love. It seems to be building there. He is on pace, as of now, to be the first ever player to have a 33-9-9 season.
Yeah. He's got the scoring average back to 34 after last night, by the way. So he got it right up to 34.0.
He's going to win the scoring title. He's second in assists. He's top 10 in steals. I believe he's 7th or 8th. There are only two other players that have had 39-9 seasons. Oscar Robertson did it four times. Russell Westbrook did it once. So, you know, you have some perspective on what this player of month award means for the larger MVP talk.
Yeah, and you know, Kat's got the numbers there on the bottom of the screen for March. 32.5 points per game, and then 10.1 rebounds, 10.1 assists.
It's a 33-point triple-double.
And so he's joining Russell Westbrook and Oscar Robertson, and Luka's had a 30-point triple-double in a calendar month before, back in November 2019. But the Big O, Westbrook and Luka are the only players to average a 30-point triple-double in a calendar month. And they've all done it multiple times now. Luka twice, Westbrook twice, Oscar eight times in his illustrious career. It should be noted that Player of the Month awards do have a barometer of winning related to winning the MVP. In 12 of the previous 16 seasons, the player who won the most Player of the Month awards or shared with others and winning the most Player of the Month awards, which could be the case here with Luka and Jason Tatum. 12 of the last 16 MVPs have come from that group of players who've won the most or shared winning the most Player of the Month honors. The outlier, Harden's MVP, because LeBron won Player of the Month like four times that year. Derrick Rose's MVP, and by the way, Steph's two MVP seasons in 2014-15 and 15-16. I think as a matter of fact, it was LeBron who won Player of the Month more than anybody else. Maybe Westbrook in 14-15, and maybe it was LeBron in 15-16. And I think, you know, you and I have discussed before, you know, obviously LeBron and voter fatigue, you know, people just stopped giving it to him because he won it so many times, which is a weird way to do it, but it is a thing. And again, the Mavs are winning. They went 11-3 in the games that Luka played in the month of March as well. So surely he's going to be Player of the Month tomorrow. It's really going to surprise me if he's not.
Well, you know, we shouldn't take for granted what we're seeing. And it's a national TV game Tuesday. That's why you're in Dallas.
Yep.
It's a Channel 8 game on Thursday. I'll be back in Dallas in the studio for halftime and postgame for that one, with a 6:30 start. So everybody should be enjoying this while we can. One quick note on the improved defense, that's something that Luka and Jay Kidd has said recently, is that the officiating has actually helped the defense because they can get away with more.
Yeah,
they can play more physically. It's something I didn't think about till they mentioned it. But obviously, offensively, it has resulted in people like Luka having to work harder for where they're going. But defensively, it's helped them, you know, improve this defense to 10th since the trade and 4th during this streak. So that's just a little quick hit for you.
That's a transition to our next point. Thanks to the Who for this little lower third, meet the new Mavs. Not same as the old
you
Mavs.
You take way too much pride in writing those.
Well, you know, you've touched on this a little bit over the course of our time, Brian, but just so people can put some numbers to it. Before these last three games, the Mavs had a stretch of nine games where they shot 32.4% on their threes. They won eight of those nine games, by the way. Well, now in the last week, the three-point shot has come back. 61 of 121 on threes in the last three games, capped by the 24 that they made last night, as you noted, the most this year and tied for second most in franchise history. So they're over 50% in the last three games. So now, moving forward here, we don't expect them to hit 50% on threes, or be up near that number. That's not realistic for them to sustain that. But get back to being a solid three-point shooting team, whether it's Washington hitting some like he did in the first game at Sacramento, Hardaway hitting some. Luka and Kyrie, of course, are a part of hitting those threes as well. Exum hit three out of three last night. Exum's 51.6%, by the way, if you add last night's numbers in. He's 51.6 on three-pointers this year, 51.6%. So, we have gone on and on, rightfully so, about their improved defense, rebounding, and paint scoring. And that picking up the slack for when they weren't shooting the three, and now the three-pointer is back. So you really do have, as you said earlier, Brian, the blend of the old Mavs and the new Mavs here in the last few games, and that really, really is exciting moving forward.
It is, and being on the road, when you see, especially the last two Sacramento games and the Houston game, and this Houston crowd, that's my hometown. I talked to people Saturday night that were going to the game. They're excited. I mean, this team wants to make the play-in, and they wanted to win that game. And just the demoralized factor of when those threes start falling, when that's added to what they're doing defensively and blocking shots, when it's added to how they're penetrating what Luka's able to do in the paint, and then Kyrie comes in, and then you get key contributions. You just see the shift in the crowd. And so this team's been on the road a long time. They're really wanting to come home, and it's going to be a fantastic atmosphere Thursday night when they do, and Friday night. But when you have this blueprint now of being able to win in multiple ways, and you're not a victim of make or miss, and you can just have a complete team because of the way the roster was built and because of the way the scheme now is built to fit that roster, These are heady times in Mavs land.
Clutch play, real quick. We're 51 minutes in, so we don't have a whole lot of time here. But I wanted to hit this. Great full page graphic we got coming here on how the Mavs improved in clutch play from last year to this year. So the clutch record last year was 26-29. Again, remember everyone, clutch games are within the last 5 minutes. It's a 5-point game, plus or minus. 26-29 last year. 21-8 this year, that's the best winning percentage in clutch games. Super clutch, as defined by me, is in the last 2 minutes within 3 points. I think that's fair to call that a super clutch because you're basically within a possession. You're playing a possession to either get back in the game or separate in the last 2 minutes. They were 20-21 last year. They're 16-6 this year. That also leads the NBA in winning percentage in those games. And look at this number that I looked at this morning. Field goal attempts in the last 30 seconds of the game to tie or take the lead. What was an enormous issue for the Mavs last year, Brian, that was shot attempts and chances to win games at the end. They were 8-30 on field goal attempts to tie or take the lead in the last 30 seconds last year. And those 30 field goal attempts happened in a sample of 18 games. This year, the Mavs are 6-7 on field goals in the last 30 seconds to tie or take the lead. That sample only includes 5 games. 2 of them, by the way, are the Cleveland games. Seth Curry, back in December, missed a 3-pointer to tie at the end of the home game. They lost to the Cavaliers 113-110. PJ Washington made a shot with 2 seconds to go to put them in a lead in the Cleveland game up there. And then, of course, we know what Max Strus did 2.6 seconds or 2.8 seconds later, whatever it was. I think we've talked a lot this year, Brian, about clutch play and how important it's been. I'm glad we brought that up, though. Look, the clutch win and Dante's shot to give them the lead with 27.5 seconds to go Friday was great. I think a really important thing here is that they have look at how many clutch games they had last year, Brian, 55, only 29 this year. They're just avoiding clutch games, number one, this year. They're not playing in as many of them. They're not as behind in as many of them. And you brought this up really early in the season. And I think this was really evident then, that the Mavs had done a lot of little things running more, more possessions, scoring more fast break points, a little bit better in terms of offensive rebounding. They were defending better, and you know that has not been a consistent thing throughout the year. They've had their ups and their downs, but obviously it's much, much better right now. But the Mavs do little things that add up over the course of the first 43 minutes. So in the last 5 minutes, they're playing from ahead and not behind. So the clutch shots that they're taking are mostly when they're leading and trying to hang on to it. And there is certainly a psychology of the lead. They're not in a position to be behind very much. And that's really helped them, quite obviously, in a lot of these clutch situations. The clutch performance and synergy of Luke and Kyrie is exponentially better than it was last year. But I think that's another part of the equation is fewer clutch situations. And when you are in them, you have the psychology of being in front rather than trailing, Brian.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up as well. Remember, 18 games were final shot right there, right?
Yeah.
5 games this year.
Yeah.
You're just not putting yourself in those positions. Remember, after the trade deadline, they were 5-13 in the clutch.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's
and
atrocious.
Now 16-6. So huge reason, you know, if you double Luka, you're playing advantage basketball. If you leave him alone, he can get to where he wants to go. The chemistry with Kyrie is there. You heard Luka's comments after the TNT broadcast where he was just effusive in his praise of how he's enjoying playing with Kyrie. And then the other players are more athletic. They're longer. They're bigger. They're versatile. You know, we just have a roster that's really been put in place well. Look, get by your TV. Get to these games. These are huge, huge games. This is a really exciting time for how this team is building.
And I think a lot of people, by the way, real quick, Brian, are also, you know, it's not just us. You know, the Luka MVP talk is gaining momentum. The other subject that's gaining momentum right now is that the Mavericks are a team that no one wants to see in the first round of the playoffs. I mean, there is a uniformity almost and agreement out there from NBA analysts right now that, and look, maybe the Mavs will be a top four team, but that's a big ask at this point. It could happen, but it's going to be tough. So if you look at the bottom four of who are going to be in the brackets in the West and East, the team that just about universally people are saying is going to be the toughest matchup are the Mavericks. And I think that's because, look, there's some numbers that we can share with you that we're going to right now real quick that indicate this is not your normal bottom four of the bracket team, because they now have won 2/3 of their games without or with Luka and Kai. I'm sorry. That's 45 games together. That's what I'm trying to say, with Luka and Kyrie. They've won 2/3 of those games. Since the trade deadline, Brian, the Mavs are 16-6, the new Mavs. And on the road, by the way, that's really important in the playoffs. I think this is worth noting, 23-14. One more road win gives them a better road record than they had 2 years ago in J. Kidd's first season when the team went on the road and won twice against Utah in the first round and once against Phoenix in the all-important Game 7 and made it all the way to the conference finals. So I think those three numbers tell you a lot about who these Mavericks really are when you're thinking about the playoffs. And obviously, Styles make fights in the playoffs, and we'll see what the matchups are. But, you know, those numbers, I think, give you a real indication of what kind of formidable team this could be in the postseason.
Since Gafford and Jones are put in the starting lineup, when Luka plays, this team's undefeated.
11-0, right? Yeah.
You know, a lot of the numbers you look at through the season, we've got to look at, and I was told by a high-ranking official in the Mavs, we got to look at everything since the trade. That's just the reality of it. They're just different teams. So that's kind of why I went through second in offense, 10th in defense, 4th in net rating since the trade. And remember, that's including some ugly play there in that little stretch of time, right?
Yeah.
So we're not just cherry-picking the good times.
Yeah, yeah, that includes
the team.
Yeah, that includes the losses in 5 out of 6 games there at the end of February.
So what's
the beginning of March?
What does our week ahead look like?
Okay, so recall, everyone, that this road trip for the Mavericks was not scheduled at the beginning of the year to be a 5-game road trip. This is a schedule adjustment. Recall that the Mavs were going to play at Golden State on January the 19th. 3 days before that, tragically, Warriors assistant coach Dejan Milojevic suddenly passed away due to a heart attack. And understandably, 2 games that week for the Warriors were postponed. One of them was their January 19th home game with Dallas. And so the makeup game of that is tomorrow night. And that was tacked on to the end of this road trip. what originally was on the calendar for April the 2nd was a home game against Golden State. And what was originally on the calendar for April 5th was a home game against the Atlanta Hawks. So now the Mavs are playing tomorrow, April 2nd, at Golden State. The Atlanta game on April 5 was moved to Thursday, April 4th. And the Mavs-Warriors home game that was scheduled for April 2nd is now moved to Friday, April 5th. And then, by the way, they play Houston Sunday afternoon at 2:30. The Rockets have a home-and-home back-to-back on Thursday against Golden State and Friday against Miami. So both teams are on level terms, Brian, in terms of back-to-back Thursday, Friday before turning around and playing what is essentially your third game in 3.5 days when they meet on 2:30 Sunday afternoon here at American Airlines Center. And that's what the week ahead looks like.
So remind me of the TV schedule. TNT Tuesday, Channel 8, and the network of affiliates around the state on Thursday. Friday is what?
Friday is WFAA and the Dallas Mavericks Broadcast Network around the great state of Texas. Yeah, and then Sunday afternoon will be on Bally.
All right.
Yeah, that and then...
And listen, Golden State's playing well. They've won 4 in a row, I believe.
Yep, yep.
You know, Atlanta has played well. They beat Boston. They won... 3 in a row, I think.
Yeah, they lost. That ended last night. They did lose, or maybe the night. Maybe it was Saturday. I think they lost to Milwaukee. So their winning streak ended, but they are playing better. They're playing better since Trae Young has been out. So that's going to cause all kinds of chatter, of course, the fact that they played better without Trae. And we'll see how things go on Thursday night. They are battling. They have a chance. But Chicago won in Minnesota last night, so you know their time's running out. But they do have something to play for. They could be ninth instead of 10th where they reside right now. And obviously that's more advantageous going into the play-in tournament. Some teams have made the playoffs out of the 9-hole going into the play-in tournament. That's happened. So, you know, they've got something to play for on Thursday night. So we've got 4 games to watch and call and work and soak in this week. We'll record our next podcast on Monday, Brian. We think we're going to do this at 11 a.m. Central Time on Monday before the eclipse at 1:42.
Oh, that's right.
yeah, next Monday. Now, by the way, for most of you who, and I think a lot of people do care about this, the National Weather Service said yesterday that the weather pattern is not looking good right now for next Monday. Yeah, there's a pretty significant possibility of clouds, maybe even rain. And yesterday, the National Weather Service put out some information, the National Weather Service of Fort Worth, that currently there's only a 15% chance of favorable eclipse viewing conditions.
Oh, no.
Now, I'm just, my dear late mother, who passed away at the age of 88 years old about 3 years ago.
Great Mrs. Followill.
Yes. The great Mrs. Followill would just say, any time that the weathermen missed a forecast, she would have a lot of vitriol about it and then just say, son, they're just forecasting. They don't know. God's got control of it. So that's kind of what I'm rolling with right now as it relates to the eclipse, Brian.
I'm pulling for you.
Well, you should be pulling for you, too, because this is a really, really big
deal. That's true.
Should be pulling for humanity in general on this, because I think most of us want to see this total eclipse in Texas next week. So have a great time in San Francisco. Eat some great food. Go check out Haight-Ashbury if you get a little while. I think that would be really cool. I think you'd fit in perfectly. You would not stand out at all in the Haight-Ashbury scene. There's a bus that you can take, the 71 bus. I think they've actually changed numbers on it, but takes you right to Stanyard, to the Stanyard bus, and then you end up in Haight-Ashbury. So check that out today, Brian. Have a great broadcast tomorrow, and we'll see you when you get back home, and check us out on YouTube, on iTunes, on Spotify, or audio, wherever you get your podcast. But check us out on video, because that's where you're going to get all of the great stuff from Cat and Chopper, the videos and the graphics here in Mavs Studio 41. That'll do it for this week's edition of Take That With You, sponsored by our longtime best buds at NTTA. For Brian, I'm Mark. We will see you next week, and enjoy this wonderful time for the MFFLs. Go Mavs!